Morning everybody, and welcome to VG Bits, the online internet video game TV show where common sense goes to die. In the Kirby series, you play as an adorable pink puffball and ostensibly uses a quenchable thirst for blood to swallow his enemies whole and steal their power-ups. But after doing some research, I've come to realize swallowing whole was generally frowned upon by dietitians. So tonight, I'm making it my mission to balance Kirby's caloric intake. To you being Kirby's adventure without eating. Swallowing mechanic is completely banned no matter what it is we swallow. Additionally, food items are also banned, those being candy, packs of tomatoes, and water bottles. I mean, I'm not sure if drinking water actually counts for eating, but he eats the entire plastic bottle, so he gets to dodge that debate. And finally, the egg-eating minigame is also banned. Take 3 guesses why. Plus, one more rule. Since the game is relatively short, we have to beat the game in one sitting. If we accidentally eat something or get a game over, reloading our save is not an option. We'll have to delete our save file and start the whole thing over from scratch. If a diet's worth doing, it's worth taking seriously. Without any copy abilities to help you, you'll have to use Kirby's main moveset. That means lying, sucking things up, spitting things out, puffing out air, sliding. If Kirby's not optimal about secret ability, face planting. And believe it or not, this isn't as game-breaking a challenge run as you usually see on the show. While copy abilities are a heavily focused mechanic, they're done more in the Super Mario Brothers style. They're nice to have, but since the player always has the opportunity to lose them, levels are made to be doable without. Every boss generates projectiles to spit back at them, and bomb blocks can be triggered with the puffer slide moves. So rather than a run that makes the game more difficult, this is more just an alternative way of playing, bringing Kirby's Adventure more in line with the playstyle of Kirby's Dream Land. Not to say the run is a cakewalk. The real challenge isn't the game design itself, but rather reaching the end without accidentally eating anything like an idiot. My first run ended just 10 minutes in for absolutely no reason than my hand slipped. One aspect where the run does change slightly is, without healing items, every hit you take is almost a permanent loss, since your health carries between levels. So get used to the game constantly yelling at you once you reach 1 HP. The only way to restore your health is by beating a world boss or flipping a secret switch, so going out of your way for those switches does actually have a little bit of an incentive. Though reaching 100% completion is probably not gonna happen. I also went out of my way for every extra life I could get, both in-level and from the impossible unfair minigames that cheat. It's not the super biggest deal, of course. Your lives counter is going to be going up a lot more than it goes down. But in an all-or-nothing run like this, it helps to have an insurance policy. The first couple worlds are easy, just don't slip your finger. But we start to see more tricky level design with level 3-4 when flying up the wind tunnel. At this point in the game, Sakurai will undoubtedly notice what you're doing and actively sabotage you with air raids. One particularly tricky moment is the world 4 boss, Krakko. See, we need to hurt Krakko by spitting out these high jump guys at him, but we can only hit him while he's low enough to the ground. And it just so happens he might sometimes try to swoop down at you while you're waiting. And while he's swooping down at you, you're supposed to duck by pressing down. I'm an idiot. There's a trick I figured out, though. All you have to do is not press down. Just don't press down. Do everything to remind yourself not to press down. Write a sticky note saying don't press down. Get a tattoo that says don't press down. Consult an optometrist and get contact lenses and have the words don't press down and apply them directly to your eyeball. After you've thoroughly reminded yourself, I just pressed down. On my third attempt at Krakko, I realize he doesn't deal contact damage while he's in his own invulnerability frame, so you're totally safe for this week if you just spit out the guy first, saving you from your muscle memory by completely removing the need to duck in the first place. After Krakko was World 5, where Kirby in World 5, he'll discover something pretty critical. Sakurai hates you. That room is luckily completely optional, so instead of walking in, just walk right past it. But no, seriously,
are you trying to get your GED? Yeah.
You don't pass that test, you do not pass this class.
Yes!
Right. Why is there a bottle of water underwater? Now, you might have wondered why I specifically made this a no-eating run and not just a no-copy ability run. Aside from beating a Kirby game without eating just being a novel concept on its own, there's a bit of a stick in the mud of a no-copy ability run once you reach Metroid. He demands you equip the sword ability before he'll fight you, and as far as I'm aware, there's no way around it. But for a no-eating run, this is no issue. Kirby automatically grabs the say how mean the Kirby Stream Lamp level is, you normally think of retro gaming throwbacks as being a modern trope, but here we've got a freaking NES game doing a throwback to a game that came out 1 year earlier, complete with black and white color scheme. Rockman 9, eat your heart out. After we beat DDD by spitting out the physical manifestation of his own failures back at him, Kirby trades in the ability to eat for the Star Rod, letting us kick Nightmare in the face and bank the ending. The Kirby's Adventure Zero Calorie Run is mission complete. And if you're interested in watching the run, I've uploaded my final successful playthrough separately without commentary. Link in the description. Special thanks to all Patreon backers, including Eric Flynn, Les Lamb, Hyper Scrub Zio, RV Rock, Solano, Mr. Harry Wonka, Mrs. Seckman, Andrew Seibert, Jay Gordon, Alexander Botkin, Chris Nate, On You, Mason 2K, JD, Robert B. Rochier, Ross Clark, Codexo, M1Guy28, Eclira, Salieri, Jez, and Meta64. Oshino, thank you for watching, and get out of my house. This is like post. Make sure you skip the first cutscene. Seriously, Kirby eats a guy in it. I didn't notice until after I already beat the game, so I had to play through it again. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to VG Mix, the online internet video game TV show where we push willful ignorance to the absolute limits. In the last episode, we discovered that it's 100% possible to beat people too without firing the main weapon, the hero shot. And so, the natural follow-up question, as suggested by literally all of humanity, can you beat Splatoon 2 without firing the hero weapons? The rule is clear-cut. Absolutely everything is allowed except for firing the hero shot, hero roller, hero charger, hero dualies, hero umbrella, hero splatling, hero blaster, hero slosher, and hero rush. Just as in Splatoon 1, sub-weapons, special weapons, and turrets are fully allowed. Additionally, weapon types outside of the hero category are also fully allowed, those two being the Splattershot Jr. during the tutorial and the you-know-what. I did try to beat the tutorial without the Splattershot Jr. anyway, but alas, my magical nose powers are limited only to the Wii U gamepad. Once we get into story mode proper, we once again have 3 levels to choose from. We're not able to buy upgrades until reaching World 2, but that's thankfully no issue. All 3 levels are doable with just the starting 8 bombs. But when I say doable, I don't mean big ones. We're already going to need some fancier climbing skills than the first game ever wanted. There are first bombs, so every wall can be a potential roadblock. The first boss is Octo Oven. Unlike the first game, bosses don't regenerate. Endurance attacks in the long term, and you can keep cluttering them up with grenades until his yeast is cooked. That's how bread works, right? Now that we've reached World 2, we make a business deal with Shelly. In exchange for using hero weapons in the field to get valuable combat data, one sucker, he'll sell us curling bombs and auto bombs. The curling bombs help tremendously in wall climbing. If there are any creases in the wall, they can ink up the crease to let us keep climbing, serving as essentially a much lower range, lower output burst bomb. Auto bombs are super useful too, since they don't get carried by momentum. They'll explode exactly where they land if they don't see any enemies. World 2 features the tricky level 6, which you might remember as the Tricky Infection, and therefore the level was designed assuming you had long-range capability. This fan is floating up in the air, out of reach of any explosions, and seemingly impossible to hit. We do have access to a stingray, which could be used to skip this whole section, but we need that stingray to skip the final section, which also happens to be darn near impossible. But there's a critical piece of information I noticed on a replay. While sub-weapons normally explode on a timer, they'll instead explode on contact with missiles. And by ludicrous divine happenstance, there's a row of missiles traveling right next to the fan, letting us make our way up and bank the Zapfish with the Stingray Cheese.
This one isn't hard, but I almost never nail a stylish finish here. Just because I can't pull the trigger doesn't mean I can't look awesome with these babies.
Our next roadblock comes in World 13, rotating targets the moon platforms when damaged. At first, it looks like some of these should be impossible, but we can still trigger them with some well-aimed ink bombs. Just look at that! It's beautiful! I probably could have avoided a lot of heartache if I bought auto bombs before coming here, but I, for one, think it takes more skill to barely fumble through like an idiot than to engage in boring strategy and common sense.
Make our way through every level except for level 14.
Parking garage throws this situation at us. The first switch triggers the wall it's on to move and form a bridge. The second switch will trigger its wall to come down and let us climb up. The first switch is easy enough, but the second switch seems unreachable.
curling bombs can hit just below the switch, but not quite all the way. Bombs that explode on top of the wall can ink the wall itself, but don't seem to ink the switch. We can, however, climb on top of the first bridge, potentially letting us skip the second switch by jumping across. But try as I might, I wasn't able to make the jump. It seems just barely too far. Sorry, everybody, but after tons of brain busting, even the help of the internet wasn't enough for this switch. This platoon.
No gun run. This mission failed.
But we're not done yet. If we can't beat Splatoon 2 without hero weapons, our next question is obvious. What's the minimum? How many times do we have to use a hero weapon to beat the game? To account for how different each individual hero weapon functions, a use is defined as firing on a single target until its state changes, whether that be a switch being pressed or an enemy being splatted. Get out your lab coats, everybody, because from now on, this is officially a squid research expedition. After firing our first shot, we get into another sticky situation instantly. We need to trigger a switch on the ceiling. But don't give up just yet. Relentlessly climb up the wall, reverse direction, and throw curling bombs at the switch. It is a pixel microscopic shot, but after about half an hour, I managed to hit it and finish the stage, letting us fight the boss, Octostomp. You might think the class would pose a challenge, but we can deal steady damage to it over time by sliding bombs under him whenever he face plants. Of interest. Level 20 propeller land has an end segment with a knee solution. Normally you need to hit both fans here to lower the zap fish and raise yourself at the same time, but we're not quite mobile enough for that. Instead, there's a way more fun option. Use the lab run as a trampoline and
fling yourself.
And there's the ultimate run killer, Experimentorium. Abandon hope, all ye who enter. Experimentorium has three paths to choose from, but we need to go down all three to finish the stage. The path on the right is super easy, but the other two are pain. In the leftmost path, we have to navigate on tight walkways and several floating switches. Throwing out curling bombs will get some ink on them, but these switches need to be about two-thirds inked until they trigger. We'd be lucky to even get halfway there. Sorry to say it, but unless we can figure out another method, the leftmost path adds on shot number two, shot number three, and shot number four. This friggin' level just quadrupled our total. The middle path is equally mean. There's five gravel hooks floating in the air, and we need to reach the farthest one. With maximum capacity, we can only throw out two bombs, so mathematically, that's some minimum of three shots, right? Sorry, but I skipped that day in math class. With two super flame shots, you can skip the first two, plus the penultimate hook, allowing you to clear all five with only two bombs. Boss number four is Octo Shower, and while I was initially dreading the fight, he's actually super easy. Bombs don't slide off his cap as fast as you might think, and the Octarians carrying him don't regenerate health, same as all the other bosses, letting you spam bombs for an easy victory. Welcome to the finale, World Bomb. The hub world itself is super tricky by this point. How are we supposed to hit that? Like, come on. There's no way. You cannot possibly tell me that we're gonna hit that switch. Well, you're right. It's impossible. But if you think impossible is gonna stop us, you have never seen this show before. See, you're able to super jump to any revealed stage. Any revealed stage, even if you yourself haven't actually been there. Just chuck a couple of bombs and there's nothing stopping you from chucking yourself up there alone, skipping the switch entirely.